So crypto markets are crazy. I've got a tinfoil hat as a result of what's going on in the crypto markets. But I've actually been doing something way bigger, and this actually isn't tinfoil. This is Radiant Barrier. And so I've been using Radiant Barrier to create a pressure zone that is air conditioned in front of the servers. So let's dive into that. But before we dive into that, I want to talk to you about something serious that's happening out there in the ecosphere. So I talked to Clyde earlier today. I know some other people have said that other crypto creators, especially in the Chia sphere, are getting targeted impersonations. I've definitely had that happen to me recently on Discord and possibly some other spots. So be very careful if you ever see something that doesn't look right. It's not a message from me. It's not a message from Clyde. Most likely, it's not a message from the real person at all. I will never send you a DM first. I will never ask you for money for any sort of Chia-related purposes or anything like that. Now, let's take a look at what's going on inside here. So I hope you guys are gonna like this. This is something that I built yesterday in response to about 102, 103 degrees of weather. And it's gonna be a little bit hard to see all of it. Why? Because this is actually a giant reflective area leading up to where the servers are. This is Radiant Barrier. And so out here is essentially the hot aisle that we're in here. This is the whole garage, this is the hot aisle. Now, why did I do this? So we were getting to about 32 to 33 degrees C inside at the air intakes, and the ambience were rising. That was yesterday at about 3 o'clock. I decided to shut down things, do some emergency work as fast as possible to try to get control of that, because I don't want them to be shut down, but at the same time, I don't want them to overheat. So definitely creating this, which this is crazy. This is absolutely crazy. And I'm gonna go through the kind of things that I did to set this up. But it actually is working. That's the crazy part about it. Like, out here, it's right now about 102 to 105 degrees, depending upon where you're at in the garage. This part here is like the hottest. If I go over there, it's a little bit cooler. So let's take a look at some of the things that I've done, and I'm gonna walk you through the process. I did some calculations. I'm not sure that I would rely on my calculations, but let me take you through really quick the hot side of things over here. So over here, I've got the portable AC. Again, not a huge fan of these portable ACs. However, I thought before I go ahead and buy the mini split, because the mini split's on back order for a while also, I might as well try this. So at the end of this, I'm gonna give you my evaluation of whether or not this is going to do enough and have enough impact for me to actually sustain. But basically what I did was, in the construction of this, and if you can see up there, it goes all the way. So it goes all the way. This is ducted out of the cat door over there, dog door, and that allowed it to actually go outside. So everything, I've got the air dams in here, everything is pushed back this way outside from that. Now I had to take the switches and front mount the switches because they actually exhaust this direction. Sometimes switches actually have a reverse direction for their speeds or for their fans. These just have this as the only possibility, so that kind of stunk. Now, here's something I did which I thought was kind of interesting. If you'll notice, there's painter tape everywhere. So I air sealed as best I could every gap that led into the ceiling. And I like making holes in walls and stuff, so of course I had quite a few of those that I needed to patch up. But you can see here, I put two high-speed box fans up here. These are directionally taking the hot air from the ceiling up and out, forcing it into the attic. There's a huge attic eaves vent down that direction, and we've also got ridge venting up there, so it should be pushing all of the heat up and out of here. So I don't know what the temperature's like up there. I need to put a temperature sensor up there and just make sure that, you know, I'm actually having the intended effect, because I am slightly concerned that what I've done here does not have the intended effect at all. Now, one of the options that I've got for what I could do is, if you see that window over there, I may be able to use that window to put one of these box fans in and then draw air out that way. That would be a little bit more traditional. That actually might work better. Another option would be at the bottom of the garage door, kind of open it up and then have some box fans here that pull air out. However, this is probably suboptimal because that'll pull most of the cold air out of the room and let all the hot air stay up here where it's, you know, rising. So let's go inside my hidey hole here. If you look, I've done sure tape, which is essentially the stuff you put on ducting. This is just radiant foil. It is perforated so it doesn't condense inside it. I built a frame. So if you see here, I built a frame that just kind of comes and sets on top of this. These members run all the way up there and attach to the front. And you'll be able to see it better when we get inside here. But you can see it's got a roof on it and stuff also. It's all taped off. It's all sealed off. I'm not going to say it's 100% perfect, but it's pretty darn good. So this is a little bit crazy. I don't like this part of it because I have to crawl in. Oh my God, it's so much cooler in here. Woo! It is like so much cooler in here. As a matter of fact, let's see if we can't see what the temperature is in here. So if you look there, 29°C is the intake temperature that we've got right now. So we've got everything directionally coming that direction. We've got our portable AC here venting up into here. It should just be circulating down and around. It looks like it is, actually. It feels like it is. Now, this allows us to have everything powered on. This Brocade ICX6610, wonderful switch. However, a bit of an energy monster. This thing's eating at least 300 watts of power. So this is something I'm going to keep an eye on, see if I can find a way to replace it. Also, I've got things now arranged so that I can power on and off per each switch. So there's metered switches on the PDUs on the back. I can actually turn off a switch. I can turn off these units because even off, these still eat a tremendous amount of power. Even if I power them off, they're still eating a ton of watts. So they need to actually be hard switched off. So these four here are right now at idle eating somewhere around this. That is idle wattage on all of this here. So that is a lot of idle wattage. That's why I definitely want to optimize as much as possible. Now when it's running and plotting, this is getting up to about 5 kilowatts that it's pulling at a time. So we also have our disk arrays here that are doing the writing to disks, also farming. Now this is the 5548P. This is going to stay on all the time, and basically this one controls what gets shut on and shut off. So everything's home runned into this now from the backside, all of the switched metered PDUs, so that I can use them to determine which things stay and which things get turned off. So if you look inside here, you can see kind of the framing a little bit better. And literally, I just was like, let's use stuff I've got laying around. I even used wood that was warped and not good. So, I mean, I literally spent nothing almost on this. Materials-wise, yeah, I cut this stuff up, but I could actually redeploy it into the attic. I had it already on hand because we've been doing radiant barrier in the attic. There's a lot of issues around that, so don't even get me started. But at some point, we will, you know, probably take this off and put it into the attic. So I put down the horse stall mat here also. This is actually holding the bottom of it in place. Now, if you see here, there's an open area. I think I actually can choke it off a little bit more once I turn these guys on and also put some filters. So I've got some cheap AC filters that I'm going to put. I'm going to put some plastic wrap on that side over there, put some AC filters in it, put some plastic wrap over there, put some AC filters in it. I'm going to move this out of the way here. Definitely going to take this opportunity to clean up all the dead everything down there. But that actually is working out surprisingly well. This whole thing, this whole setup is working surprisingly well. So there is two things that I would say. One, not a problem keeping up with this unit over here, which is again about 5,500 watts when it's fully cranking out plots. However, these are not powered on at the moment. Now, you can see that there's a huge difference in the kilowatts being used here, so this is using like 100 watts, just hanging out, doing nothing. So that's essentially the idle state of all of these, with their IDRACs being able to be turned on. So once I turn these on and start kicking out plots out of these also, that's going to add additional heat load to the outside. That's going to come back in through the intake area, which this is the intake area essentially. And so that is going to be something that we definitely have to take into account what we do with it. So I think if I were going to continue this, I would need another portable AC. I'm not a fan at all of portable ACs. However, big problem, all the walls stucco. So cutting a hole in a stucco wall, not something you can just willy-nilly do, something that actually has to, you know, have professionals out to, you know, do all the ceiling and everything around it. So not something easy to do, not something fun to do. So I can't just pop a window unit in here. If I could, I definitely would. If you are orientating things and you're thinking about doing this, you definitely should wait until you've got a window on this side before you put racks on this side so that you can have an AC inside here essentially cooling this entire area. That would have been my number one takeaway, is if I could redo it, there is an area where we have actually a window. I'll show you that. However, the orientation of these racks, the electrical, like, literally not a non-trivial task to switch that up at this point. I mean, that would be a week's worth of work easy to switch that up at this point. But, you know, I gotta say, things are looking good. Things are running great. Things are really quiet as a result of that. And I really appreciate that, because it was quite loud when I was just pointing this essentially directly at the front here. It was not going to be able to keep up. Now, that is because we are in a 2011 cycle of heat in Texas, in my estimation. That's crazy. That part right there is crazy. I don't like that part. We're in a, like, 2011 cycle of heat, which basically, in my opinion, is going to lead to a very, very hot year. So check it out. Sealed up all of this. Sealed up all of this. Now, this is perforated, so I'm sure the air can come in and go through on the backside. Little bit's fine. Sealed up all of it, everywhere. Take you really quick over here. You can see that we sealed up all this around the backside of it as well. And I took, you know, a fair amount of time doing this. Got pretty hot out here doing it, to be honest with you, so was very much happy when it was done. Overall, if you have a setup and you're in a hot environment, this is something to definitely consider. Now, if you have any input on this, let me know, because this is creating a definite, like, negative pressure zone. So I don't know if I can. Yeah, so definitely creating a pressure zone here with that. Not thrilled about that. I think that that probably is also impacting what's happening as far as the cooling. So let me know what your thoughts are on that. I'm not married to that at any rate. I think that that could definitely change. So going outside here to cool down from being in the garage there, outside of the cool zone, it definitely is 105-ish, probably to 110 in most of the areas. Not comfortable at all. Now, once you start cranking, I've got it up to 115 in those uncontrolled areas. So there's a couple things that I definitely think would be big takeaways. One, if you've got a window and you're doing racks for the first time, try to orient your racks to where the face of the racks would be towards the window. If you're going to be doing this in a garage setting, I think that that's something that could save you a ton of headache. Second thing, are you sure you shouldn't just be air conditioning the entire garage? The reason I didn't go yet to a mini split for the entire garage is because I had all this stuff laying around. Gonna be honest, it's a little bit clickbaity, and I thought, why not? It's a YouTube video, I might as well do something. So this was something that was fun. Also, it was a crypto crash day, and I just didn't want to look at the news anymore about crypto stuff, so I was like, oh my god. So I had fun doing that for a couple of hours, and it was entertaining. If you are thinking about this, insulation is something that you would definitely want to consider. If you're looking at a whole garage, insulating a whole two-car garage is not a trivial task. However, with tools that you can get and drilling and filling in the walls, you can do that pretty, you know, cost-effectively. You can hire somebody to do that. In the attic, you can just spray in, if you don't have decking, some insulation with one of the blower machines with a friend or something like that. Be done in a couple of hours if you start early in the day. Even in Texas, you won't be melting in your attic. So I would definitely consider doing that. I think I'd probably end up going with the mini split at some point in time, probably a 3.5 to 4 ton unit for that size of a garage, because I'm probably adding two more racks in there. So the heat load is just that great. It dictates basically what I should be doing. And there's really just no good way that a portable AC will be able to provide enough cooling, even if I brought another portable AC in, even if I brought another portable AC in on top of that. Like, those are not going to add up to big cooling capabilities. So having it boxed in like that and then drafted so it can bring in just enough of the outside air is something that does, you know, present a viable option. But I think at three racks, and with the kind of machines I'm running in those three racks, I'm about out of options. So probably going to go ahead and do a mini split. Supply chain is a little bit backed up, so Mr. Cool DIY unit, probably keep an eye out. I think I'm going to end up going with one of those. They've got a Gen 3. If you know anything about them, sound off, let me know what you know about them in the comments below. But they've got a Gen 3 that looks really nice. It's built for, like, server rooms and stuff like that, so I figured I would give that one a run. All right, everybody, make sure you hit me up at GoSpaceport on Twitter. The website is digitalspaceport.com. Make sure you hit that bell, because tomorrow the load is coming in from Lawrence Livermore National Laboratories. we may be going live. I don't know what time it's coming in. They're not giving me a date and time, but they did give me a date. So that's something. I don't know. But I'm excited to see what we got. And as we crack those servers open, praying for DDR4, praying for DDR4. If we got DDR4, if we've got some really cool GPUs in there, that really dictates what happens next. So hope for the best, and we will see you guys tomorrow.
Be sure to hit like and subscribe, and check out these videos for more information on your favorite crypto topics.